Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank y'all for having me again. I, like you said, I came here last year and I brought the harpsichord to do a concert of all American music in the 18th century. And this is kind of the same period, but it's going to be going over to England instead. First off, has anyone here seen the clavichord before right now? Because I want to show real quick, like you said, it is a very soft instrument. Most people either use it to perform in small areas, like living rooms or drawing rooms of people's houses, or in small churches, but it wasn't usually a performance, it was more of a practice instrument. So, if you feel like you can't hear it, you're welcome to come up as far as you need to. I don't really mind. I'm good with whatever. One thing about the clavichord that is unique in comparison to all keyboard instruments at this time is that it has this ornament called bebung. It can stretch and bend the pitch depending on how you place your finger on the key. Some composers, like C.P. Bach, like to use this as an emotional effect to bring out the sadness of the music, if you want, or to enjoy like a high part of a melodic line. This makes it a little bit difficult because if you press the key too hard, more than you meant to, you'll just sound like you're out of tune. The clavichord, it's a lot more difficult to play than the harpsichord or the forte piano at the time, and C.P. Bach even writes in his treatise back then that you can play the harpsichord or the piano, but you can't play the clavichord. But if you could play this clavichord, you would be able to transfer those skills to other instruments. So it's expected that keyboardists back then, if they were very serious about becoming a major pianist in the area, that they worked on clavichord first and built from there. Which I agree with. I started this instrument about a year ago, and it is very difficult to play. If you approach the keys and just barely press it, it makes a sound, it's just a chucking sound that you can't hear at all, and just nothing sounds. So I'm gonna play one quick piece just to get you a little acclimated. It's called In Airy Dreams. Concert is part of my series of focusing on the novelist Jane Austen. One thing we know about her, did not know much about her, is that she is a classically trained musician as well. She studied keyboard and voice, and her family have a whole selection of music in their library. Over 600 pieces are found there. And about 3 or 4 years ago, the library was digitized for public use. I've put the link of the library, if you're so interested, the link is down here at the bottom, if you want to find these pieces. And under any pieces that I got from Jane Austen, I put in parentheses the name of the file and the page number. Because all the pieces that I'm playing tonight, they're not really available elsewhere, on an online format at least, or at least I have not found them. So, 5 of these 9 pieces come directly from Jane Austen. Now, has anyone here read Jane Austen or this novel specifically, Northanger Abbey? Yep. Okay, a few people. Then if I say something wrong, you can correct me. I don't mind. Northanger Abbey is one of her earliest written novels, but it didn't get published until after her death because of the whole issue with a publisher that kept it, even though she wanted to buy it back from them. I want to first start focusing on the protagonist, Catherine Morland. So this program is called The Curious Fantasy of Catherine Morland. This reading comes from the very first chapter of the book. Jane Austen writes about Catherine. No one who had ever seen Catherine Morland in her fancy would have supposed her born to be a heroine. For many years of her life, as plain as any, she had a thin, awkward figure, a sallow skin without color, dark lank hair, and strong features. She was fond of all boys' plays, and if she gathered flowers at all, it was chiefly for the pleasure of mischief. She was often inattentive and occasionally stupid. She enjoyed books, provided that nothing like useful knowledge could be gained from them, provided they were all story and no reflection. Her mother wished for her to learn music, and Catherine was sure she would like it because she loved playing on the old keys of the forlorn harpsichord. She learned for a year, but she could not bear it, and Miss Morland, even though she wanted her daughters to learn, she did not insist on her daughters being accomplished. And the day that Miss Morland dismissed the music master was the happiest day of Catherine's life. Music in all of Jane Austen's novels has a presence. It's normally in the background, but most of the heroines in her novels are musicians in some way. Elizabeth Bennet and all of her sisters play piano whenever they go to balls or gatherings at other people's houses. Emma Woodhouse and Jane Fairfax are pianists as well. They're even in a bit of a rivalry throughout their novel. Because back then in London at this time, women tried to show that they were accomplished, helping to marry up and raise their social status. And learning music, being able to sing, was one way to better yourselves. So Jane Austen, from the first chapter, wants to point out that Catherine is not one of these accomplished women. She's not raising her status. She doesn't, not that she doesn't care about music, but she really did not enjoy learning it. And she was not forced to keep learning it. While that might not mean as much to us today, for any audience that read this back then, they would immediately know that Catherine is, she's no Elizabeth Bennet. Whenever you look at Pride and Prejudice, Elizabeth Bennet is a very strong woman that has her own ideas and goes, you know, she comes off as abrasive to some people because she is very confident in herself. Whereas Catherine Morland spends most of this novel being very naive, agreeable. It takes some time throughout the novel, but Jane Austen spends the story raising Catherine to become a true heroine. So, the next piece I'm going to play is called Fairy Dance, and the inscription says, Fairy Dance as danced in the high circles of fashion. And I picked this because Catherine's story, she lives in Fullerton, which is a very small town. She's never been in these big cities before, but then she gets to come with Mr. and Mrs. Allen to the city of Bath, and she starts seeing these concerts, the theaters, the balls, and the dances, and I'm imagining this would be one of the type of pieces she would have heard them. The person that arranged this turned into a rondo, so you'll hear the same theme coming back with middle sections being a little bit more contrasting. Thank you. next reading we're going to read from comes from chapter 6 of the novel. And this is when Catherine meets Isabella Thorpe and their friendship starts to blossom here. Isabella says to Catherine, "When you have finished Udolpho, we will read the Italian together. And I have made out a list of 10 or 12 more of the same kind for you. Here they are in my pocketbook." And here she's listing Gothic novels: Castle of Wolfenbach, Claremont, Mysterious Warnings, Necromancer of the Black Forest, Midnight Bell, Orphan of the Rhine, and Horrid Mysteries. Now the point here is that this whole novel is seen as a parody of Gothic novels in general, and Isabella here is introducing the horrid Northanger novels, or that's how we call them now, the horrid novels of Northanger Abbey. And every novel that she listed did exist back then, and there's even a press, a Minerva press, that is publishing these now, if you're so interested in reading what these characters are talking about. Mysteries of Udolpho specifically is one of the most popular Gothic horror novels of the 18th century, written by Anne Radcliffe. And Radcliffe comes up a few more times in this novel as well. But basically, Catherine and Isabella, they bond through their love of novels, but it is a sort of a rocky one, because for those that have read this, Isabella is basically just using Catherine to get closer to her brother to hopefully marry him, which she gives up on when she realizes that they don't have money. Because back then, how much money you had was a big part of who you're going to marry. And Catherine's hobby of reading novels, it's also a major plot point for her ongoing romances between Henry Tilney and John Thorpe. On one hand, Henry Tilney loves reading novels, John Thorpe does not, and it creates a bit of a tension between her and John, because he says he would never read anything, he would never read Udolpho, but he would love to read any book by Anne Radcliffe. The irony here being that Anne Radcliffe did write that. He's just, I don't know what the word is, he's basically just putting on airs, and she does not. She eventually, you know, she does not find him very agreeable. So, I wanted to spend the next few pieces I'm going to play are pieces I wouldn't really get to play on harpsichord ever, because these are going into the 19th century. And by this point, the harpsichord has phased out. It doesn't really keep up with the demands of new pieces. But the clavichord still lasts. It goes until about the 1830s. So I decided to try to do some new music here. Picked out a Chopin prelude, a Schubert transcription, a Mozart arrangement. The Schubert song specifically, Gretchen am Spinrad, it's about a woman named Gretchen daydreaming, thinking about her love for this man, Faust. And she's at the spinning wheel, which you'll hear represented through this just constantly going the entire time. And the translation is, "My peace is gone, my heart is heavy, I shall never ever find peace again. When he's not with me, life is like the grave, the whole world is turned to gall." It's a very emotional, very emo-like piece, and she just spirals a little more into going crazy over this love that she cannot have. But before I go into that, I'll start with a Chopin prelude. I hope you enjoy it. at this point, I think we'll take the intermission.
Good.
Yeah. And, yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.